that was one of the things that went, whoa.
You've been around since really the birth of cinema.
That's right. I've been around forever.
But it's a 40-plus year career. This is pretty amazing.
Has it really been? I was telling Eric when I came. I first place I came to live was right here, the Sunset Marquee, and it was my brother and I were doing the Long Riders years ago. It was a Western that I, you know.
But you wrote.
I wrote, produced, and but it took a long time to get made. It really did. But let me see. Armie and Bernstein was working on the script. It brought back all these memories as I crossed the pool. So I. You know, that's hard to believe, 40-year career. Yeah, that's right. I've been here a while. Anyway.
Well, like your first credit, I think, was 1972 as an actor.
Something like that, yeah. You know what? I'm so lucky that I'm still doing stuff and I like and like. I love this movie that I just did. It's everything I could have ever wanted to do as a director and as a filmmaker, because I got to work with a star, a big star. And you know, even in where he is right now, in his talk soup, is what we like to call it. You know, with what he's going through, he's still this incredibly charismatic, special guy. And so I got to, and I get, it was a great story. It was a fantastic story. And the people I got to work with, like Trevor Albert, who's a great, great film producer himself, and Elisa Bonar, the editor, and you know, we literally spent 3 years in a submarine working on it. So
when did you first meet Glenn?
I met Glenn about 4 years ago.
So you didn't know him through?
No, I didn't. You know, Julian Raymond, who was the producer of Glenn's last two albums, and he's in the film as he's not a character in the film. He's the real producer of Ghost on a Canvas, which was Glenn's last album. Would come over to my house where I have an editing room, and he was working with my son Johnny, who was at the time 14. And Johnny's a great musician, and he has a band, and Julian's at Warner Brothers, and they were, you know, had hopes of developing him into something big as the years went on. So he would come over, and he knew that I'd done Walk the Line, been involved with that. And kept saying, "Man, you got to meet Glenn." And I kept thinking that, you know, he wanted us to do the narrative version of Glen Campbell. And he said, "No, that's not what he's going to go out and tour." Mm-hmm. And
because I had that impression also. I remember during the Walk the Line thing, I think we may have talked in Toronto at some point for one moment during the film festival.
Right.
And there was I seem to remember the conversation being about trying to do a narrative around Glenn.
Yeah.
As a future thing.
It had been discussed.
Yeah.
But Julian said, no, that's not what I'm talking about, James. He said, you know, although maybe sometime in the future you'd want to do that. And probably I would, because Glenn makes Johnny Cash look like a choir boy. He really does, man. But he said he's got Alzheimer's, and he's going to do this little tour. And you know, I have a lot of film equipment and cameras and editing facilities. And he said, why don't you just, you know, come out and record it? And so Trevor Albert and I talked about it and said, you know, do we really want to do this? Well, it'll only be 5 weeks. Well, 5 weeks turned into 2.5 years. 150.
One of the things in the movie is the kind of rolling number of concerts.
Right. Turned into 151 shows. And so, you know, I mean, the thing was, we went and we saw everything we could on Alzheimer's and what it does to people. And we wanted to see documentaries, you know. And honestly, with all due respect to my fellow filmmakers, I didn't find anything that was uplifting, entertaining. All I found was stuff that was really depressing, and it wasn't. There was no compelling characters. It was just a model of a disease or something like that. So you saw somebody sitting in a chair, and this is what happened, and this is what the doctor says. This, so it's talking heads, and so we came back after the weekend of watching these things, and together said, "Listen, we'll meet Glenn, but I don't know that." I don't want to disappoint him. So anyway, Glenn walks into the house, and there's Johnny walking across the living room, and Glenn looks over at him and says, "Hey, I play guitar." And Johnny goes, "Yes, sir, I know you do. He says, you want me to show you something?" And he takes the guitar, and he just said, "This is what Uncle Boo showed me." And he goes, and just shreds it. He absolutely shreds it. And Kim said, he can still play. And he said, you know, he's got Alzheimer's, James, but this tour is going to, Glenn looks over, he says, "I don't have Alzheimer's. What are you talking about?" "I got part-timers. I can't remember anything." He said, but he could remember that, you know. And then Johnny leaves the room, goes away for 10 or 15 minutes. And Glenn starts doing things, saying things like, "You know, when a man finds a good woman, he finds a good thing. I found me a good thing." He'd point to Kim. And you could see this incredible love between these two people. And you could see that she was so patient and just, it was really beautiful. She's 30 years younger than him. So she's got a lot more energy and she can keep up with him. And she was very protective of him. But she was not pulling away from the fact that he had Alzheimer's. You know, she was saying, you know, Glenn's very real. He's an honest man. In fact, he would say frequently to me, we called him the Buddha because he would repeat certain things over and over again. And this was one of them. "Lying's bullshit. You can't lie, cheat, or steal." He said, "That's not right." And he would say it, you know, and he would repeat it, or, you know, and he would say the thing about a man findeth a good woman, and he said, you know, and he would talk about his faith. He would always say, you know, and he would always tell you he loves you. He said, "I love you." You know, he was just the sweet, and he would always crack jokes. So we knew right from the get-go the guy was accessible. You could talk to him. The elephant was in the room. In fact, the more you talked about what he forgot, the more he laughed at it. The more it was okay. I just remember one time we talked to a lot of his friends in Nashville, a lot of musical people, and they were all sitting around a table, and you know, we were having dinner. And I said, "So Glenn, how's the Alzheimer's coming along?" Which I do in the film too frequently. And everybody looks like, "Holy shit! What did you just say to him?" I said, "We're making a movie about a guy who's suffering from this. You know, the elephant's in the room." He said, "It's fine. Doesn't bother me." You know, and kill you, you know, and all of a sudden his friend, I said, "Glenn, what did you forget today?" And he'd say, "Well, I don't remember."
So the movie is very, I mean, it does have that intimacy and that kind of like, the elephant is always in the room in the movie, but it does get darker at times and lighter at times. I mean, did you have that kind of access from the beginning, or were you more part of the road crew at the start and became more part of the family as you went along, or?
I don't know. I'd like to think I had access pretty quick because I think it's because his kids really liked Trevor and I, and Glenn and I, we talked a lot about addiction. We talked a lot about real shit. And you know, he would get, just like you and I are talking, we'd talk about stuff. And then the talk would get repeated. And so there was a certain intimacy that happened when he knew I wasn't afraid to ask him stuff. And and then I'd tell him about my life and some of the things that happened to me, which was very similar to my relationship with John Cash, which we became really good friends. And Glenn actually, Kim said that he wanted to make the movie more than he wanted to play music. He knew it was important because, you know, there's a moment in the film where he, just after I told him, I said, "You know where we're going? We're going to go to Washington and we're going to try and get these guys to pay attention to this thing." And he says, "Would you like to make a difference with Alzheimer's?" And then he talks about Alzheimer's in the film. Right. He really wanted to, he knew what he was in for, and he wanted to change the conversation.
So when it gets hairy in the film, and there are moments of rage that finally, you know, crop up every now and again. I mean, he is so charming and so kind of happy most of the time, and then there's, you know, there are those moments where there's some anger at his frustration that he clearly has. I mean, was that just being in the right place? Was that one of 50 times?
It was one of several times, surely. It was the one we chose because of the connection with Ashley and my dad came up, you know, and he just totally forgot that moment had happened. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we have 1,300 hours of film. So mm-hmm. it's kind of like making Walk the Line. You make a movie about a guy who's a drug addict. You don't have to see him shooting up over and over again to right. know what it's like for him to shoot up. Mm-hmm. If you just do it once and do it right, you get the impression and you know that the journey's about. To shy away from it, you know, would have been dishonest, and that would have been not something that we wanted to do. To, you know, so hopefully we chose the right frame to put it in, and that's, I guess, what the filmmaking's about.
So. Did you have a sense of where you were throughout the whole process, or did you have to kind of stop at the end and consider what the arc of the film, the story arc, would really be? I mean, did it just present itself and was it immediately clear?
Well, you know, the film actually started one way and then drifted into another reality. It started with 5 weeks. We're going to be here for 5 weeks. Mm. And then it turned into 2.5 years. And during that period of time, all our lives changed. And we got to see, started at stage two with his illness, and at the end was stage four. So you got to see this progression of him losing a lot of ability to be a normal cognitive conversation. But when I began, I knew nothing about Alzheimer's, you know. And, you know, when we began, you know, here was a guy who was told to hang it up, right?
Oh, yeah.
You know, he says, hang it up, man, you know, which is what most people do. You're given a serious, you know, diagnosis of something, you go, fuck, you know, that's it. You know, it's over. You go sit on your pity pot and you hang it up. And Glenn went, I ain't done, man. That's not what's going to happen here. I'm going to go. I'm going to play until I can't play anymore.
Well, there's also the conversation I was thinking in the movie about, you know, that you could embarrass yourself, essentially. Every time you go out there, there's that chance that something terrible is going to happen, that people are not going to be forgiving or understanding. And that's, you know, when you have such a legacy already, it's kind of a huge risk.
I think that he basically felt like, you know what, Kim will say this, Glenn's always been honest, even when his addictions and his crazy days, mm-hmm. you know, he didn't do what the steroid guys in baseball do and say, I didn't do that. Yeah. Glenn went, I did do that, you know, and I guess everybody appreciates a repentant sinner, and who among us has not sinned, you know, so, and you know, sin or fucked up, mm-hmm. So Glenn, he wasn't afraid of it, you know. He's just a very pure guy, you know. What you see is what you get. He's not hiding anything. That was the other thing, you know. It's like there was no shame in his game. And what he's done, what the film has done, is people are now, they're saying to me, people who have dementia and see the film, and they're mm-hmm. saying, thank you. I no longer feel shame. Families that have, you know, I won't mention his name, but a very significant producer, film producer, studio head said, you know, I think Campbell could become a verb. So what do you mean? He said, well, when I saw this film, Glenn was told to hang it up. He said, if you're going to, I'm going to Campbell it. Well, what do you mean by that? He said, I'm not going to give up. I'm not going to quit. Because, I mean, this is like Rocky with a guitar. This is a guy, you know, and the thing that was great too is that he always made light of the situation. Mm-hmm. You know, it was just, you know, he's a funny guy.
Well, you know, it's interesting because in a narrative feature, you always, you know, in an action movie, you talk about the clock and how, you know, there's always that the ticking time bomb in an action movie. This movie has that. I mean, it's kind of remarkable and surprising as an audience member because it does, by the end, it becomes this thing where, okay, we're at 140. Are we going to be able to do 142, 140? You know, and one by one, it seems like they're just, everybody's waiting for the moment where they, you know, he's done all that he can do before it just kind of just all collapses underneath of him.
Absolutely. It started that way. The bomb was put under the table the second he got the diagnosis, mm-hmm. you know? And, you know, the classical, yeah. The bomb's under the table, tick-tock, tick-tock, you know? Yeah. And Bobby Gale, right in the first show we did, there we were at the Tonight Show, and he says, and I look at Bobby, and she's, tears are welling up in her eyes, and I say to her, says, what's wrong, Bobby? I just don't know if he's going to be able to get through this. Everybody felt that way, you know? And then the audience felt that way, too, and they didn't know. But instead of booing him, or they lifted him up and they cheered him on. I mean, he had 15, 17 standing ovations at Carnegie Hall. Mm-hmm. You know.
Well, I love the Larry Gatlin.
Oh, isn't that great?
Yeah, his bit, because it's that is, I think, it kind of encapsulates.
Yeah.
The idea that the audience is really, you know, either they're trying to be a positive person, or if you're trying to be negative, there's no really reason to be there.
Right. Well, but I think they came. Well, Bill McClay says, he says, I think some people came anticipating that they were going to see a train wreck.
Mm-hmm.
He said, you know, he hate to be a cynic, you know, with regards to his fellow human beings. And he said, but that didn't want to happen. They came and, you know, when he'd go down, they brought him back up. And Edge talked about it. It was a fascinating interview we had, and talk about the, I said, so what is it when you're on the stage and you're playing in front of all those people? What do you guys have a back and forth? He said, oh yeah. He said, it's a conversation that we're having with the audience all the time. It's like a give and a take in an organism. And that's what's so cool about doing theater too, when you're really on it.
Right.
You know, and that's just the whole thing was, Glenn was having this conversation with the audience, you know, and they, like I said, they were lifting him up. It was just, I got to stand on the stage. You know, this was my first time as a cameraman, as well as a director. I directed a lot of stuff, but, you know, they normally didn't let me. I did the other documentary I did, I got to run a steady cam, which was great, except my back. But I was staged, I did a lot of his close-ups, and he would walk over to me during the shooting sometimes and in the middle of a song, and he'd put the mic up to me, and he'd go, like a rhinestone. Glenn, no, cowboy, you know. So it was an interactive experience as well as just a really fantastic journey.
So when it got to be a year, say, where were you? What was your headspace like at that point? Were you kind of like, were you wanting to continue for another year and a half, or were you ready to be done at some point? Or
I kept thinking, I don't know how much longer he can go.
Mm.
And then he did an incredible show.
So you were in his world at that point.
You know what happened is we became so committed. We became part of the Merry Pranksters. You know, we were part of the whole thing, and it became really important because we would take little segments of it, and then we'd go show it to people in different organizations, and it would really, really empower them. It was really powerful to them. And you could see, and they were rooting us on. You know, it's like the audience was rooting Glenn on. We had people that were, this is really important, James. You got to keep going with this. You got to, and you know, so, and then it just became, you know, the life's work. It's like saying, you know, this is really important. You know, whatever gifts I've been given as a filmmaker, this is where I get to use them. So.
Well, the timing is fascinating because it really is. It does feel like we're in a moment where people are living longer, and this disease is now becoming much more. A part of our daily conversations, particularly for those of us who are now over 50.
Be me. You just said
no,
I have a 40-year career. I came out of the womb acting up.
But I mean, it's you know, 20 years ago, it was somewhat of a rarity. It wasn't, you know, and now it's becoming more and more, you know, whether it's Alzheimer's or Parkinson's or combinations, becoming a part of almost every family. It's not
well, you know, the statistics are 1 out of 2 people who hit the age of 85 will have dementia or some form of Alzheimer's.
Mm-hmm.
5.5 million people have it today in America. That means that's affecting 15 million people in the family spectrum. 44 million people have it worldwide. By the year 2025, it will exceed the national defense budget. By the year 2050, 150 million people will have it. There's nothing to slow it down or to stop it. So, if you do the calculus, it'll break the economy. And I'm not, you know, I mean, it's, and I just don't understand why they give, and just, listen, I lost family members to cancer, to heart disease, and everything else, but they give several billion dollars, $4 or $5 billion to cancer, and three or four to heart disease, and three to AIDS, and a half a billion dollars to, this is for research, for research for Alzheimer's. And with this, so we got to get our balances right. We got to, and you know, as one of the politicians said, it's not Al-Qaeda or ISIL you should worry about knocking on your door.
Yeah.
It's this.
So it's not, it's a weird thing, because I think there's a sense that as we continue to live longer, that maybe we're just not built to live long. Our bodies are going to somehow, you know, when you hit a certain age, it's just we're not really meant to.
Well, but we've struggled, medicine has struggled to keep it, so now the, you know, heart disease becomes a plumbing issue, and, you know, so the brain, they just haven't been able to, you know, we all want to live longer, we've been enjoying the quality of our life's good, we've spent all, invested all this genius in medicine and money, and so, you know, this is I don't think it's the last frontier, but it's certainly one we've got to deal with, and I think what's so great about the film, from my point of view, is that Glenn has brought a face to it that is positive, upbeat, accessible, and human, you know, and musical. That too.
Yeah.
You know, he's also a musical genius. But for a guy that, he said, this is who I am. This is what I got, and we can deal with this, you know. And
well, the ability to trace his history is also an extraordinary opportunity. I mean, not very few people have their entire lives on, you know, videotape somewhere, so that you can really know, which I think is why so many of the other films about this subject or around this subject are dry,
right?
Because you only really have the person who's now ill. You know, you start videotaping the day they get sick or whatever. But this guy, we all have a relationship with him after, you know.
Yeah.
Particularly those of us over 40 or 35 or whatever. But I mean, I remember the Good Time Hour and everything else, and you know, the Wrecking Crew had the documentary a few years ago, and people were very interested. It's part of people's lives.
Yeah.
He is part of people's lives in a very real way.
Right. Yeah.
You were never up against him for a part?
Glenn?
Yeah. He acted for a while.
No, he...
He's 10 years older than you.
He didn't play bad guys like I did, you know. He was much too good looking. He would have gotten the part.
Yeah. So was acting for you a means to the end of being a director, or was that your dream when you were a kid? Or?
Actually, when I was at Yale, I wanted to be a director. I was at Yale Drama School, and I was always wanting to be on the other side. And Stacy, my older brother, I would actually go watch him do plays, and I'd sit in the audience. He was part of the professional company, and I was a student, and he'd say, "What do you think?" And I'd give him notes. And I always wanted to do it, and I think my dad had always wanted to be a director too. And my mom told me a story years later. I was directing something, and he said, "You know, it's really sad that your dad didn't keep going. I guess he got fired from his first job as a director, and it broke his spirit." Broke his heart, you know, because he, you know, and so it's something, I guess, that it's always been in my family, but I feel, you know, I didn't start doing it till later in my life, you know, till I was over 30, no, maybe 40.
Do you miss it?
Do I miss acting?
Yeah.
I'm acting right now. No.
To whatever degree people are, but I mean.
Yeah, you know, I do actually. I love acting, but I hated the process of auditioning. Really hated it, because I felt there was such disrespect for actors by directors and producers. You know, I'll never forget going in for a major role in a major film, and both the director and the producer were on their phones during the audition as I was reading to a camera like right here. And I went, this is bullshit, man. You know.
So you must know as a director that the difficulty of trying to make that process less painful for an actor. It's hard.
I do. I actually write letters to actors and thank them for coming in when they had come in multiple times.
Right.
And I always say it's not how tall you are, or how fat you are, or thin or anything like that. It's match. You know. And I try to reassure them to keep going, because that, you know. And I actually had, well, actually Bill Maher came over to me one day, and he was up for a movie years ago that John Travolta got the part in, and that I was producing, and I was also acting in, and he said, "You know, you did one of the most decent things anybody's ever done." So what are you talking about? He said, he'd auditioned. He was an actor at one time, and he said, "You wrote me a letter, you know, thanking me in appreciation for the time that I came in and auditioned, yeah, because he got like 4 or 5 callbacks. He was right there, down to the last 3 guys. It was a picture of Paramount. And he said, you know, it was almost worth not getting the part, getting the letter, because it made me think that Hollywood wasn't totally filled with assholes.
He's found out otherwise since.
No, I don't think that at all. That was Bill. That wasn't me. I don't think that.
It's a tough business. It's not a. It is not for sissies.
Well, you have to learn that no doesn't mean, you know, it's over.
Yeah.
You know, you have to. Just like Glenn.
Yeah. Well, I think to be in some ways the whole thing of performing, and living, is what's one of the things that's fascinating about watching the movie is you get a sense of. You know, how he conducted his life in terms of never losing that passion. You know, there was always that, it was always his guitar.
Yeah.
There was always work that he, you know, had that love for and brought him back, no matter what other foibles were going on.
He would say to me, he said, I saw it. He said, I don't care if it's 2 people or 20,000. He said, I play it the same way for everybody. Mm. And he did. We were at the Mayo Clinic when we went up there to do the tests, and we did a tour. And he came into this room, and it was filled with elderly people. And Trevor and I always carry a guitar with us, because we knew if he got agitated or anything, we could hand him the guitar. You know, and it could calm him down, because he felt like he was, it was like having a, you know, something to nurture him. And these folks are sitting around a table, and Glenn picks up the guitar, and he says, want to hear a song? They go, yeah, sure. And then he plays this song, and there's like 5 people there, and he kicks ass with it. It's fantastic. And this little old lady says, you're pretty good. She had no idea who he was. You're pretty good. And he said, well, thank you. And so cut to now Glenn's in a memory facility. This is in March after, you know, and he needs to be, the doctors have all said it's time for him to, because he's for safety, you know, to be taken care of. He's happy. He's very happy there. So Kim has this little guitar there, and she's with him. And Glenn, you know, asks if they want to hear a song. Kim was amazed that, you know, he got the guitar, he played 2 songs. And then he looked at everybody in there. I want to thank everybody for coming. And he went over and laid down on the sofa and went to sleep. So, you know, he just, doesn't matter, 2 or 20,000, doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. He loves to sing, and he's incredible.
So is it odd for you for it to end? Or, I mean, do you consider it having ended, or is it?
I don't. I actually consider in some ways that it's a beginning, strangely enough. The movie is ending. But what it's done, it's actually made me a real advocate for wanting to take what Glenn has done and create this conversation. We started a foundation, and you know, I think Glenn is, you know, wanting to make a difference with his music and who he is and what he is. I think it's kind of infected all of us who've worked on the film. We all want to do the same thing. That doesn't mean I'm not going to make more movies,
right.
But it means that I'm going to take a good portion of my life and dedicate it to trying to help other people deal with this, and lift up their spirits. By the way, hopefully the movie does, because I think a lot of people, I'd do this at the Q&As, I'd say, well, there's a couple things that we've done. It's been really unbelievable. We did a screening in Nashville, for 4,500 people a couple weeks ago at the Music City Center. And the band Perry played, we did a concert afterwards, and it was really great. It was unbelievable, actually. You know, standing ovation of 4,500 people. It was pretty cool. And I just said, just for the heck of it, you know, I was also the MC of the show, and I said to them, I said, so would everybody in this audience who's had a family member who had Alzheimer's or a caregiver, would you stand up?
Mm.
3/4 of the audience stood up. And I said, so how many of you people thought you were going to see a movie that was a bummer? 3/4 of them kept their hands up. And how many thought it was? everybody said, no, I wouldn't want. So, we accomplished the mission. That's what Glenn would want. Mm-hmm. He would want, he says it in the movie, it's better to laugh. I've laughed and I've cried, and it's a hell of a lot better to laugh. So I think there's as many big laughs in this movie, for me anyway. Yeah. I've witnessed it over and over again. There are big comedies. There's huge laughs. And there's a few.
It was very entertaining for me. I mean, it's funny because I was thinking about this the other day, that I'm watching all these documentaries. The shortlist is coming out soon for the Academy Awards and all that. And so there are a lot of people doing documentary stuff for the last month or so. So I've seen a lot of films. Many are very, very good. But there's a much smaller list of those that I would consider actually entertaining on some level. And usually they're not necessarily as dramatic as this one. But this is one of those that's actually a good time watching a movie, besides all the important stuff that's going on inside of it, which is nice.
I felt, I guess it's my whole experience in narrative storytelling, that this is a hybrid. It's a, without it being anything but authentic in the truth. I know they call it reality television. I've been on the sets of some of those things, and they're telling, it's a script, it's bullshit. Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of it, some of it's, I suppose when they do an operation and they show a guy's brain being cut open, I guess that's probably real. Yeah. But in this case, Glenn Glenn didn't even know the camera was there. So he became like a character in a dramatic movie. Mm-hmm. It's like I don't know if that makes sense. It's like it's a very different experience. I don't think I've never seen this movie, this kind of movie before.
Well, the access and the amount of family around him and the relationship with his wife and the kids.
Yeah.
Being on stage with him that whole time, because their presence is always
it's
a unique and interesting part of it. You're always kind of watching them, even when he's doing things.
How about that girl?
Yeah.
She's something else. And, that was the other thing that was really cool. I have a lot of kids that I love very much. And they became kind of my kids, mm-hmm. In some ways, I got to see them grow up as performers. When we started the tour to where it ended, I mean, they could deal with anything. I mean, there was some nights where Glenn wouldn't let them have you would start in the wrong key, and they would just adjust. Mm-hmm. They'd just play the song in the wrong key. It's like Larry Gatlin said, So he wanted to sing Wichita Lineman twice. Who gives a rat's ass? Let him sing it twice.
Yeah.
But.
And for you and Glenn, will you continue to visit and see him and be part of his life till the end?
Yeah. I was with him a couple weeks ago, and every time I go to Nashville, the first time we showed the film at we wanted to do it in Nashville, the Nashville Film Festival. We wanted to do it very specifically because those are his people, the music world down there. And then we had an event afterwards where they, at the Country Music Hall of Fame, where they did a special celebration of Glenn and his career and all that stuff. And it was kind of like the moment in the film where I say, thank you for letting me make this, for doing this movie, and he goes, no, thank you. I didn't know what he was going to say to me, and I had that same moment when he walked over to me, and I didn't know if he'd still recognize me. Mm. And he walked over to me, kept looking at me. And he touched my beard, started going like that. He goes, you, God bless you. Sweet. He recognized me, because he used to do that when we were on the road. He'd recognize me by my beard. I wonder if he knew my name in the last year at all. But it didn't matter. He knew my essence, And it's special. Yeah, I'll always go see Glenn.